Als je wat, dus, als je wat ziet wat je interessant lijkt voor die projecten, meld je zo snel mogelijk erop aan. En als je dan het hebt afgesproken, je hebt het uitgewerkt in wederom, jullie kennen pas, nu ga ik niet helemaal opnoemen. Begin eraan, want zoals de jongens van vorige week ook zeiden, hoe langer je wacht, des te minder tijd je natuurlijk overhoudt. En dan kom je altijd wel in de knoei met de planning. Dus leun niet achterover van, ik zie wel wanneer ik het ga doen, ik begin zo voortvaren mogelijk. Nou, een aantal van jullie hadden gemeld over de presentaties, wanneer die online kwamen. Ik kijk even naar Elmer, maar volgens mij, er zijn er twee, drie dingen die zijn opgenomen. Die ga ik hopelijk zo direct meteen plaatsen. Dat lukt even niet om een andere reden dan net, maar goed, dat is waarschijnlijk zo gepiept. Omdat het online staat op YouTube, kun je het rustig nakijken. En vergeet ik dan nog dingen? Oh ja, een hele belangrijke, de week, ik hoop dat jullie dat ook hebben gezien in het computer forensics gedeelte. Hebben jullie die opmerking gelezen van mij, die week? De eerste week van maart, lees dat even helder door. Ja, we hebben vrij bijzondere gastsprekers. Ik wil, ga die mensen maar even googlen, als je dat niet gelooft. Maar Eric Filiol is een zwaar gewicht in deze industrie. Als in, dat zijn mensen die gewoon, kom even naar de Pacifische Oceaan een week lang aan NATO lesgeven. Dit soort mensen. Dus dat wil je niet missen. En het wordt best pittig, dat kan ik wel beloven. Echt technisch best pittig. Het wordt niet onredelijk natuurlijk, we houden wel rekening met de verschillen in de groep ook. Maar dat zijn buitenkansjes, want als je dat soort dingen met succes afsluit en dat zet je op je cv. Van ik heb van die en die les gehad een week, dat verkoopt best goed, denk ik. Dus pak dat, dat soort kansen. Nou, vandaag hebben we ook een hele bijzondere gastlezer. Het is Carla Bombelt, misschien sommigen van jullie die kennen haar al. Carla is onder andere, ze vertelt ook nog wat een en ander over zichzelf zo direct. Carla geeft onder andere de Iris Covery Miner. Die is net als ik verantwoordelijk voor een van de minoren hier. Zeg ik dat goed? Miner Iris Covery. Ook al een aantal jaren. Carla is altijd bereid om een gastlezing, waarvoor dank, te geven over informatiebeveiliging. En ik zeg er meteen wat bij. Het lijkt misschien een hele hoop verhaal en weinig techniek. Maar als je goed oplet, dan snap je dat dit wel aan de basis staat. Even voor de duidelijkheid, dat heeft niks, ik ga niks zeggen over informatievervuiling. Computer security is een bijverschijnsel, zeg ik heel oneerbiedig, van informatiebeveiligen. Dit is veel belangrijker en veel grootschaliger en nog veel ingewikkelder in een hele hoop opzichten dan het voordeel wat wij hebben als nerds, voor een groot gedeelte, dat we kunnen piemen met computers. Dit is nog veel groter en belangrijker in een hele hoop opzichten. Maak heel, en ik wil jullie nogmaals op het hart drukken, maak alsjeblieft veel aantekeningen en let heel goed op. Want dit is echt gewoon waar het op de grote schaal om draait. Industriële schaal, grote bedrijven en waar het uiteindelijk allemaal onder valt. Zeg ik dat een beetje redelijk? Dus zoals altijd, nou Elmer doet even een... check, ja. Staat het allemaal goed?
Staat allemaal goed. Zo moet
Oké, okay, nou dan geef ik. Ben ik al dingen vergeten? Volgens mij niet.
Volgens mij niet.
Oké. Okay. Nou dan klap ik je even af voor de soundsync weer. Heb je de
synchronisatie?
Ja. Oké, okay, nou dan 3, 2, 1.
Take one. Oké, thanks to my dearest colleagues Arnim en Elmer, who just left. I've been asked to tell you something about information security, and it had to be done in English. So that's why I use the English language as much as possible. Introduction on information security. Subtitle, what's in it for you, or what's in IT for you? I see a lot of guys and even two girls, great, who want to know everything about computer forensics. But computer forensics is only a part of digital forensics. And digital forensics is necessary to use as an instrument to do investigations where you need information that is being electronically stored to find out what has happened. That could be a security incident. Information security is the ground layer, and if you know what is about information security, then you can take on to the next step and do something about computer security or network security or mobile phone security. But we do it because we need information security. What's on the menu for today? I'll tell something about me, myself, and I in the introduction. Then I'll walk you through the seven men. And if you want to get your information security in order, it's a good use to take the basic principles to successful information security at heart. Then I'm going to discuss with you how can you achieve the best possible information security. Well, one of the components to achieve this is raising awareness. Make people aware of what information security is and what the importance of information security is. And finally, I'll sum up what we have done. Introduction. Well, Arnim and I mentioned the name, Carla Bombelt. I work at the University of Applied Sciences, Amsterdam, media creation and information. For the main time of my job, I work within the Knowledge Center, Create IT Applied Research. And within this Knowledge Center, I'm one of the persons who is working in the Knowledge Circle Electronic Discovery, together with Arnim and Elmer and David van Dijk. And we work for and together with Hans Henseler, who is the professor for e-discovery at this University of Applied Sciences. If you do an investigation, specifically a criminal investigation, you always talk about the MMO of a criminal, of an offender. The MMO, what means? Does a person have, what motives does a person have, and what opportunity does this person grab to get what he wants to get? Well, my means, of course, I have an education. Long, long time ago, I studied something, and if I tell you what I studied, you might laugh. I have a master's degree in German language and literature. So that's quite something different than informatics or computers. But I used to translate German text about computing into Dutch. I thought it was the end of the 70s, the early 80s of last century. After being a teacher in German a couple of years, I made a career switch. I went into automation. I started to apply for a job because there was a lack of experienced computer people, and a lot of companies were seeking for academics to become computer programmers. So I joined. And I became a programmer, a junior programmer, to start with. And I programmed, for example, in third generation languages, long, long time ago. I wrote a lot of applications in COBOL. Maybe somebody heard of the COBOL language. I also wrote in Fortran, whatever. I started to use databases, create databases, mainly on mainframes, big machines for the Dutch railroad and for a lot of clients, because I was always lend out to clients who needed extra personnel. I had the regular career during those days. You started as a junior programmer, then you became programmer, senior programmer, then you became systems analyst, systems designer, project leader. And when I was project leader, I saw a lot of, excuse me for the word, shit at the clients. And I noticed that a lot of people didn't know the bottom line of what structured working, structured and documented working needed. So I switched again back to education, and I started teaching all about computers and information systems, first in at the University of Applied Sciences in Breda. Then after about 7 years I switched to Rotterdam, and then I think it's about 6 years ago I switched to Amsterdam. And during all these years I had a couple of interests that started to deepen, and one of my topics of interest was information security. I did a lot of courses, I did a lot of jobs for clients, and then something new happened. When something happens in the United States of America, you can wait until 4 or 5 years after that moment, then it comes to Europe, and maybe it comes to the Netherlands. And this thing was called electronic discovery. In the US you have a culture of when somebody has the feeling that he has been done wrong, you can simply say, I sue you. Well, the legal system in the United States is like, if I want to sue a person, I can claim all the material this other person has to hand over to me so that I can look into if the claim I am going to make before the judge is, well, substantial. And a lot of documentation and documents today are not on paper anymore. They are electronically stored. And that, in connection with information security, has become my main field of interest. That's why I, for example, Arnie mentioned it already, have a minor on e-discovery in the part-time education program every first semester on Monday and Thursday evening. So if somebody likes to follow this minor, I'll start again September after the summer holidays. It's not so technical as computer forensics is. It's more like, how do you perform an investigation using digital forensics to look for traces wherever on the IT infrastructure to put together the puzzle. Who did what, when, why, and with what? Okay, every time when I meet students, I want to share all the knowledge I've gained with them. And one of the opportunities is, of course, doing a lecture. That's why I'm standing here doing a guest lecture on information security. And if somebody, a student, wants to do a final assignment on information security or electronic discovery, then I could be the person to accompany that student. But only if you want to achieve an 8. If you are happy when you achieve a 6, then I'm not the person that you should look for another teacher. If you want to excel, with my help of course, well, because I want to not only share what I know, I want to inspire you to see things in another way, and I like to stimulate your originality and your creativity. You are more creative than you think. I'll come back to that later because they've signed me up for the next quarter to do biometrics for you guys. And if you want to, you have a possibility to choose the course Electronic Discovery. So after this session, where I'm performing a guest lecture, you will see me again next quarter. Seven Men. There was a writer, a poet, Rudyard Kipling, who wrote a lot of stories and poems, and he talked about six men. When I looked at the poem, I thought, well, he didn't mention the seven men. So, the six serving men are the questions you always have to ask if you want to investigate something. What is it? Where is it? When did it happen? Who was involved? With what did this person do it? Or how did it happen? Why? Why did it happen? Why did this person this? And why just in that location, there, and at that time? And if you can answer all these six questions, you can answer the remaining questions. What for? What goal? If you do an investigation, for example, an information security incident has happened, and you want to know what happened and how it happened, then you use these seven questions. These seven questions I will use in e-discovery. But these same seven questions you can use in computer forensics. Arnim and I are a great tandem because as a team we did two times now a masterclass during a week on digital forensic investigation in France at the University at Laval, where your guest speaker, guest lecturer Eric Filliol is coming from. And Eric Filliol asked us, the both of us, to do a course for his masterclass students on network and security, and we performed together digital forensic investigation. I was the lead investigator for all the procedures and the way how to perform such an investigation, and I had the technical man of the house, of course that's Arnie, because he's the specialist, the expert on computer forensics. But you can't dig up all the traces from a computer if you don't know how to put these pieces, these traces, into a picture, in a puzzle, like a puzzle. That's where these questions come in, and that's where the investigation method comes in. These seven questions I'm going to relate to information security. We start with the most simple question, what? What is? Because the topic is information security, we have to find a definition about information security. So, if you talk about information security, the first thing you need to know is what is information, what is security, and then the two together, what is information security? The first is information. Information in the world of today has a great value. That's why organizations, businesses, call information today an asset. An asset is something that has a great value to an organization. And if something is an asset to you, you want to take care of it. You want to protect it because it has value. What's security? Well, security are a lot of controls, safeguards, measures you put in place to protect your assets. If an asset is, for example, if you look at a bank, the money in the bank is the asset. So the bank has to put in security to protect the money in the vault of the bank. And the money in the vault has to be secured from threats. Nobody is allowed to enter the vault in the cellar of the bank to get to the money, only if you are allowed to. And you have to protect the money in the vault with all kinds of measures, for example, steel doors, gates, guards, whatever. So if something is of very great value for you, an asset, you have to secure it. And if information is an asset and you want to protect it from threat, then you can imagine that information security relates to the protection of information. And that is the bottom line. Information security is about protection of information, because information is one of the main things of value for every organization. If you have no information, you can't do business. If you can't reach to your information, you might be out of business. If your information is too late, you could have a problem. If the information is damaged, you can't send out invoices, you can't do payments, you can't do anything. And if the information is not available at all because your system went down and you are an airline company, you don't know which persons have booked a seat in what plane and how late the plane is going to fly away from Amsterdam. So information is a key asset in today's business environment. That's why we need information security for a, well, I can't start summing up what threats there are that are threatening information. I'll talk about it later. The only thing you know is you have to protect information, because if you don't do so, you could lose your business continuity. The organization goes down. Some organizations want to grow, but that's a second goal. The first goal is to stay in business. And of course, you have to make a consideration as a business to find a balance between how many risks do we accept and how much money do we want to invest to mitigate the risk and to have our information security in balance. That's always sometimes more risks, sometimes more money, but you need to find your ROI, return on investments, so the money you put in to get some measures must be enough or fair in comparison to the business risks you want to mitigate. So it's a balancing act. That's what. But where do you find information security? Well, that's quite an easy question because it has an easy answer everywhere, all over the place. Finally, your information, if it's electronically stored, you can find it somewhere on your IT infrastructure in the form of ones and zeros. But those ones and zeros represent a piece of information, and this piece of information can only be read or viewed if you have an IT infrastructure in place. And this information, zeros and ones, if you transform or translate it into something that is for a human readable or viewable, we have applications for that, then you can use it in all the services and all the processes you have in your business. So on the technical side, your information is in somewhere in the IT infrastructure, and on the business side, your information goes in and out your business processes. You are in the technical side, but you always have to remember that what you do with your IT infrastructure is only because you need to protect information. And this information you protect for the business. So people in the IT infrastructure business are always supportive to the business processes in an organization. And if you stand in the middle on the information, you have to be able to make a translation between the information as we humans can read and view it, and how computer people are able to store it and to make it safe and secure on IT systems. So if you want to stand in the middle, you have to know something about both worlds. And you are a quite kind of intermediary between the business and the IT. Because information crosses from business to IT, from IT to business. So it's all over. When do you have to have information security? Another quite easy to answer question. Always. Because we are IT minded, we think only about digital information. But you don't have to forget, there's a lot of analog information too, paper. We'll focus mainly on the electronically stored information, so the digital form of information, and we don't talk today about the analog version. But I will tell you more about the two shapes in e-discovery. What's important is, if you only look at electronically stored information, just like paper, it comes into four states. You can have information being data in use, so your active data that you can call upon, that you can read, that you can write, that you can change, that you even can delete. So your active data, your actual data, is data in use. What's more interesting is data in motion. Data travels a lot because we don't use only standalone computers anymore. All our computers are connected into smaller or bigger networks. When a computer is a client in a network, then you have network traffic and your data is on the move. With internet connections all around us, Wi-Fi, whatever, there's anytime, anywhere, data in motion. You can't grab it out of the air, but it's somewhere there. It's not visible yet, but you can make it visible. Sometimes, if data is not in use or in motion, it could be at rest. We keep a lot of data. We store a lot of data. Because storage is cheap today. And if you buy a thumb drive today, it can gather several terabytes of data. It's a different era if you compare it with the old-fashioned floppy disks. So data at rest is somewhere on a removable storage medium. It could be an archive. It could be a backup tape or another backup medium. And when you no longer have data in use and no longer want it at rest, you can make it data out of use. You can destroy it, delete it. But as you know, as IT people, if you delete data, it's mainly logically deleted. And especially in computer forensics, you have the possibility to retrieve deleted data and make it live again, if you have the right tools. So really data out of use is, well, quite difficult, because you don't have to delete it only logically, you have to delete it physically as well. So it has to be wiped off the storage medium. And in paper terms, you have to put it through the shredder. Well, that's not enough, because it's possible now to put all these pieces that went through the shredder together again. It's quite a puzzle, but we have tools for the moment that can help us reconstructing a shredded archive. It's now being done with the archives of the Stasi, the former East German Staatssicherheit, the intelligence agency, started shredding all their archives, and they had about 15,000 bags of shredded pieces of archive, and they are now in Germany trying to put all these shredded archives together again to find out what was in these destroyed archives. And if you want to destroy a hard drive or a CD, then don't throw it simply in the bin. You have to overwrite it several times, but the best way to do it these days is to put it in a shredder machine, where it comes out at the end of the machine in tiny little bits and pieces that aren't going to be put together again. Because you can always find traces of the data on a storage medium. It's a very interesting field of research. So if you want something to, if you don't have a project or a topic, this might be something to look into. So one, always, even if data is in use or in motion, at rest, and even if data is out of use. Who? Well, it's the same simple question with the same simple answer. Who needs information security? Everyone. Information is part of a business. Information is used, stored, transmitted, addressed in IT systems and IT infrastructure. The people who own the information and the systems have to pay for it. Then you have the people who develop the IT infrastructure. They build applications, they build networks, they build whatever kind of components that are combined into an IT infrastructure. Sometimes these developers have help from consultants, how to do something, or what is the best way to write an application, or what's the best way to build a network. After a system or an IT infrastructure is developed, it's going to be used, and if it's in use, it has to be administrated. So here you have the people who administrate the network, the applications, the data stored in what shape or form. And it's all meant for the users. The users, they work with the information. They decide if the information should be sent to somebody else, should be stored somewhere, should be deleted, or whatever. So all these people have to be aware of information security, and that's not so easy, because all these people come from different worlds and they talk a different language. If you talk with a system network administrator, he will use a lot of acronyms. TCP/IP, well, we know what we mean, but a user doesn't know what TCP/IP means, what it stands for. You hope a developer knows what it means, and that a consultant knows what it means. And an owner, well, he or she doesn't matter if it's with TCP/IP or platform. An owner will always talk about how much does it cost, what can I earn. A user will always talk, well, if it's simple, I don't want to have to put too much effort into my work, I only am interested in the information to use. And how it's on the system or in the system, well, it doesn't matter to me, I simply want to get it out of the system. And a consultant, well, the most consultants can only say things like, you have to do this or that. And as a professional, you are asking a consultant, yes, but how? And then you don't get a nice answer that you can use. So everybody in an organization needs information security. That doesn't mean that everybody in an organization knows about information security. That's different, Cook. How do you do information security? Well, take a look at this. Simply, everything that you can imagine in the area of information security, you can put it under one big umbrella. I won't talk you through all these bubbles, because this is how broad the information security field is. It has something to do with compliance. Is what you do as an organization conform the law? A according to the law? And can you prove it? So you have to administer a lot to be able to prove to the government or to the tax office that you did it right. And sometimes you have to check it yourself while auditing, or you are going to become checked by an external auditor. Therefore, you have to put in place a lot of policies. You are allowed to do this, you are not allowed to do that. And if you do this, then you are only permitted to access those applications, and you are not allowed to use that data. And if you want to use a computer system, you have to get into the building, into your room, and after you, and if you want to leave your room, you have to lock the door. And if it's the end of the workday and you want to go home, you have to follow the clear desk policy. So everything on your desk has to be put away into a cupboard and locked. And if you want to make information systems or applications to work with your information, you have to do your software development in a secure way. But shit happens. Sometimes something goes wrong and you never know when it goes wrong. So if there is an incident, you have to be able to respond in a correct way to a security incident or whatever incident. Therefore, it's nice to be able to find out early enough that somebody is trying to get his hands on your information. So it would be nice if you have an intrusion detection and prevention application on your system. Or, because data is quite a lot in motion, it would be very nice if you at least have some antivirus detection on your system. And it would be even nicer if you want to communicate with certain partners in your business that you can use, for example, encryption or digital certificates. Then you have to be able to use a PKI or PKI assignments. And you have to be sure that only the people you allow to get into the IT system, to allow to get into an application, to allow to get through the application to the data, you have to make access controls on every level, from outside of the building to the final piece of data, through your access controls. And access controls only works if you do something that is called key management, because I give you the authorization to do something. But I am able to get the authorization from you if you're no longer an employee of the organization. And if big bad shit happens, then you don't have incident response, then you have to be able to recover from a disaster. A fire, a plane crashing into your building, or heavy rains and your computer systems are in the basement and the water is dripping into your cellar. So if a disaster happens, you have to be able to recover as timely and as soon as possible. And on a day-to-day basis, your IT infrastructure has to perform according to the arrangements you made, and the information has to be available 24/7 or from 9 to 5, depends on the arrangements, and you have to have operations controls in place to monitor the constant performing of your IT infrastructure, and therefore the information going through your IT infrastructure. And to achieve all this, you have to perform a lot of training and make people aware of the risks they are under and the risks they are producing and what the effect might be on the information. So information security is just an umbrella. See what's under it. Quite a lot. So I'm not going to focus on any of those bubbles. I'll talk you a bit through this later. Why? The sixth question is, why do we need information security? Well, you need it direct and you need it indirect. The direct reason for information security is quite simple. You're an organization, you are in business, and you want to be in business tomorrow, next week, next month, next year. So the main thing is you want continuity for your business. And you have, as board of directors or management, put some targets for your organization. We want to make 10% profit next year. Or we want to employ 10 extra people. These targets can't be reached if you just sit there and wait. You have to do something. You have to perform some activities. Doing business, performing your business processes. But to get to your targets through your activities, you have to sacrifice something. You have to put some resources into your business. Money. Time is money. People is time is money. Maybe you have to put equipment into your business. So you have to make sacrifices to be able to do your activities to reach your targets. And the management or the board of directors of every organization wants only to know two things. How efficient are we and how effective are we? Efficient says something about the relation between the activities and the sacrifices you have made. They have to be in balance. You are not going to sacrifice quite a lot if the activities can be performed in an easier way. So that's the first balance the management has to find. And you only want to do those activities that can help to reach the targets. If you do something but it doesn't help to reach your target for 10% profit, or we want to have 10 extra employees, then you do an activity that may be nice but it doesn't help to reach your target. So that's called effectiveness. And the management wants to know always how efficient are we and how effective are we. And how get the director or the board of directors the answer how efficient and how effective are we? True information. Information about where are we standing now? Are we performing well? Can we do better? Are we underperforming? So information is very crucial to know where you stand. And this information can be in two shapes, remember? It can be analog on paper, and it can be digital, electronically stored. Those pieces of information that are electronically stored are somewhere in your IT infrastructure. So you need information technology, IT, to produce that information that can give the answer to the management board of directors. Because the management only wants to know how efficient and how effective we are. They need information, but they have some crucial points they put on information, and if it's digital information, on the IT infrastructure, named CIA. C was for?
Confidentiality.
The I.
Integrity.
And the A?
Integrity.
Bingo. If you would translate it into Dutch, then here you would have BIV. B-I-V. Betrouwbaarheid, integriteit, vertrouwelijkheid. So the CIA is the English version, and the Dutch version, you can encounter it in BIV. So your information has to be continuously, it has a high level of integrity and should be available whenever it's needed. The digital information coming from somewhere out of your IT infrastructure demands that this IT infrastructure has the same continuity, integrity and availability, because if your CIA of your IT infrastructure is bad, it reflects on the digital information, and information that is not fully CIA has a negative impact on where do we stand. So we are going to look into information, mainly digital information, in relation to the information technology used to store, transmit, archive, and use digital information. That was the correct way. So where do we stand? Thermometer into the business, and we need information. That's direct. Indirect, if the business, the management or the board of directors doesn't have the information that is CIA, it can negatively influence the competitive position. You could be out of business, or if some information out of the market or what consumers are doing doesn't reach you in time, and you can't compare it with the information out of your systems, you could make a wrong decision. You could be out of business. If you don't know how many money you earn, and you don't know how many money you have to pay, you could be in problems because your cash flow is not right. If you don't know what a product or a service that you deliver has cost you, then you don't know how profitable you are. If you are selling products at prices that are too high, and your competitors sell similar products at lower prices, but you don't know it because your system doesn't give you the information, well, it could be not so profitable, could be negative on your cash flow and you could be out of competition. If you don't know if your IT infrastructure is performing according to what you thought it would be, it could be end of life. If you're an airline company and your booking system, your reservation system is down, it costs you tens of thousands of euros per minute. Hundreds of thousands of euros per hour. Millions per day. So you can't afford that your systems are down and you can't deliver the services that your consumers or your customers rely on. It's even worse if the taxes you have paid are not enough, or somewhere in your financial administration did something go wrong, but you can't prove it, then you're not complying with the tax regulations and you get a large fine. And this fine could be so large that you could be out of business. And what to think about those companies that have problem after problem after problem? Well, this bank has a DDoS attack again. Oh, we can't pay with our credit cards through this bank today and even yesterday. Do you want to stay with that bank or do you want to join another bank? So it's something about the image. So indirect, you have a lot of consequences about the direct reason that not or no information is available according to CIA. Now you've seen the separate questions, the what, the where, the when, the who, the with what, the why, the what for. But how do you get your information into CIA? In other words, how do you achieve information security at a balanced level? I'll talk you through the basic principles to success when it comes to information security. You can think about it as 12 stepping stones. You start with the first step, then you go to the next, and so you step 12 times. And if you want to do something in a different order, you can start with 12 and then to 10, but you need to step on every stone. You see 1 to 12, I'll talk you through. The first one. There is no such thing as absolute security. 100% security doesn't exist. 100% truth doesn't exist. So if a company or a service delivery organization claims that it will have 100% security for you, don't believe them. Even 99.99999. It's very hard to achieve. Think about the 80-20 rule. You know the 80-20 rule? Have you had it somewhere in your educational program? De 80-20 regel? It takes 20% of the effort to reach 80% of the results. And for the last 20% to get to the 100% results, you need an extra 80% effort. Or you can talk in money. So 80% is very nice to start with. Every percent above the level of 80 costs a lot. And you will never, never, never achieve absolute 100% security. Keep dreaming. Because this guy is always there in the background, Murphy. Everything that can go wrong will go wrong. You don't know when it will happen, but it will happen. Shit will always happen. Murphy is always there. I think you have experienced Murphy already during your education here at the HVA. You had a deadline. You had to deliver a report. And just as you thought you were early enough to finish it before the deadline, your computer crashed, or the person with whom you were doing the assignment got ill. You printed out the copy, but you lost it on the way to school. That was Murphy. You thought you had everything under control, but no, you can't get Murphy under control. Murphy does what he wants, at any time, he likes, in any form you could never think of. And you are IT people, so you are used to back up your system on a regular basis. You have copies of all your important documents, not only on your computer, but on a thumb drive or an extra hard drive. You have a full backup of image of your complete laptop, that if something shit happens, that you simply can put your image back again. I see nodding heads. Keep it up, guys, because Murphy will attack you. Maybe not today, not this month, but he will do. So there's no such thing as absolute security. No guarantee for 100% security. Be aware of that stepping stone. Because the next stepping stone, you already know, the CIA, the triangle, or the CIA triad, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. So CIA not only apply it to your IT infrastructure, but also apply it to your information. Because that's the main thing we are interested in. No information, no business. No information, no report. No information, no nothing. We can't live without information. We can live without IT. Well, it's a bit harder these days, but we can live without IT. We can't live without information. We'll die. We are lost on an island in our own, at our own, with nothing. And we have to do it with the information that is stored on our human storage medium, what we have in our brains, in our memory. Well, that's limited, you know it. I'm not going to talk you through what the CIA exactly means, because I saw that in your introductionary lesson on security, the CIA came across. The third stepping stone, defense in depth. Don't have a single point of defense. Remember I talked about the money in the bank? The money in the bank was put into a vault. The vault was secured. Steel doors. The room where the vault is in with steel doors was outside guarded through those guards with maybe guns or whatever. Thick walls. Outside of the building, cameras. Fences, whatever. So don't rely on a single point of defense. Do defense in depth. Layer on layer on layer on layer on layer. You can call it tiers or whatever you like. And here's an example. The bottom layer is physical security. Then you have data defenses, application defenses, host defenses, network defenses, perimeter defenses, layer on layer on layer on layer. And somewhere here, or here, are also our zeros and ones. So we have to put our information, our electronically stored information, behind a lot of layers of defense. Don't put your information simply out into the open. It could be dangerous. So defense in depth, the third stepping stone. The fourth! Oh, yes, the weakest link. Maybe you know the British program, the quiz with Anne Robinson. You are the weakest link! Ouch! Yes, we humans are always the weakest link of nature. Humans make mistakes, but humans write application programs. Humans design and develop computer components. Humans develop and design and put together network components. Humans design defense mechanisms. So if you know that humans can make mistakes, and they will, and if you think I don't make any mistake, Murphy will be sure that you will make one. And you keep people, humans, on their own, they don't do the most horrible things. So if you want to put layers of defense into your organization, you have to start and to finish with the humans in your organization. That is where the criminals today are starting also, at the employee in an organization. You know what social engineering is? If I'm kind enough and I know to trigger you on the right points and ask you politely the right questions, I get the right answers that I need to break into your system or into your organization. That's social engineering. Making use of the weakest link of a defense strategy. I don't think that anyone of you remembers this little fireman with the three O's. It was a commercial long, long, long time ago in your eyes. But it's still accurate. Onwetendheid, onachtzaamheid, onvoorzichtigheid. The three O's. Because of these three O's, shit happens. Well, you can, the like this one, just stick my head in the sand. And you know what people do when you have a blocked road? That's not for me. I won't stop at the gate. I'll go around. When left alone, people tend to make the worst security decisions. Remember the weakest link. You are the weakest link. We are the weakest link. The fifth step is done. Requirements. Yes, it would be very nice if you could specify what to do and how to do. What is allowed and what is not allowed, and how you can achieve this. You need three things. Policies. 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 Those written down lines, you are not allowed to, in case of emergency, call. In this building, smoking is not allowed. Technologies. Well, we can't do everything on our own. We need help, and we use technology to help us. And third component, there comes a lot of legal and ethical issues with it. What is allowed? What is not allowed? Can we put a camera in the corner of this room? Can we put a camera in front, or can we tape or record the guest teacher only when asked and permission is given? So if you have a conversation with somebody and you are taping this conversation on your smartphone, it's illegal if you didn't have asked permission to record the conversation. Ethical. Yes. What is allowed to get security on the highest level? Is it allowed to do a background search on a new employee? Yes, it's allowed. It is in the policy. If you want to apply for a job nowadays, you can be almost certain that the organization you are applying for a job is looking you up into the internet, is looking if you are on Facebook, if you have a Twitter account, if you are on LinkedIn. That's perfectly legal. But to use personally uploaded information that is actually only meant for your friends as part of your soliciting for a job, is it ethical? Not ethical? You can have a discussion about it. The NSA eavesdrops on everybody everywhere. Is it legal? Yes, on the US law it's legal. Is it ethical? No, it's not ethical. But it's done. So think about requirements, not only in the functional way, what to do and how to do, but also in the assurance way. Can we rely upon the requirements if we afterwards have to come forward and say, what did we do? Did we do something that actually is illegal or is not ethical? The only thing you have to be aware, security needs should be established based upon risks, obligations from regulations and business contracts, and the principles, stars, and demands of the organization. So you only have to look if you only look into the risks and what is allowed legally and ethically, then you are most safe when you are going to define your principles, targets and demands. And what is legal today could be illegal tomorrow. And what is illegal today can be legal tomorrow. If you smoke weed and you have a little portion of weed in your possession, that's legal. But if you have possession of a little amount of weed, you have to buy it somewhere. That is semi-legal. But if you are able to have it in possession and to buy it somewhere, it must be possible, made possible, to grow weed somewhere. So why is having weed to smoke it not forbidden and growing weed forbidden? Well, that's a Dutch solution. Six stepping stone. Security through obscurity is not an answer. To put everything and everyone on a chain, put a policeman next to every employee in the organization, putting cameras anywhere in the building, having your webcam of your camera on the tablet or your netbook or your smartphone always on is not the solution. To forbid everything is inviting everybody to try where is the boundary, how can we cross what is forbidden. Be open about it. Don't say this is not allowed, point. You have to say this is not allowed because explain yourself. Don't keep it in the dark. Be open about it. What's hidden in this closet? A skeleton, maybe. Yes, the main thing. And I will shortly go through, because this is a very important topic. Security is fully based on risk management. You have to know what are the risks for my organization. What measures can I take to minimize these risks? And what will it cost me to minimize these risks? And what will be left on risk? So you have to think about the risks you as an organization are facing. I won't talk you through all these things, but you have risk on the material side. Your resources, your factory, your facilities, your building, your machines, your equipment. You have operational risks, your daily operations, something can go wrong. You have products, when you make products, you have a liability as an organization when you sell these products and there's something wrong about the product, or if you deliver a service, your service is not at a good level. You have financial risks, fraud. Liability is not only related to the product or the service, but you are also liable relationship with your employees. As employer, you are liable for what your employees are doing. Work risks, yes, if the circumstances are bad when you have to do your work, you can fall or it's dangerous, then you are liable as employer. And if you lose a couple of key persons in your organization who know all about IT systems and they have a lot of knowledge, and they go to another company, You have a great loss. So, if you talk about risks, it's not only about information-related risk or computer-related risk. It's all about what are your important assets, information. You are the owner of information as an asset. And there are a lot of bad people inside your organization and outside your organization, threat agents. As an owner, you want to keep your information as an asset safe and secure, and a threat agent wants to get hold of your information. Your asset is at risk. Why is your asset at risk? Because people made the asset, so there's always at least one vulnerability. Mostly there are more vulnerabilities. And a bad person knows there is a vulnerability to get hold of your asset. So this threat agent performs a threat. As an owner, you are smart. You know that your asset is at risk because there are one or more vulnerabilities. So what do? You put countermeasures in place. And with countermeasures, you're stopping your vulnerabilities from being used by a threat, so you minimize your risk, so your asset is more safe and secure than it was. But the threat agent is a smart one. He thinks about a new way to get hold of your asset. So this is an ongoing game. When you talk about risk management, you have to look into the level of hardware, the level of software, and the level of data. I simply show you this. These are the types of vulnerabilities that are possible. And if you are doing risk management, you are performing a risk analysis, and you are looking into what risks are your organization, is your organization confronted with, and then you can give it a color. The more red the color, the higher the risk, and the more green the color, the lower the risk. So everything that is red, you want to mitigate. But if you can't afford to have it too cost, too much, but you can't afford to have it at a too great a risk. So, what to do? I don't know. You have to put some countermeasures against vulnerabilities that could be used by a threat to get hold of your assets. And they are called controls, security controls, countermeasures, safeguards. And you know them about as preventive, detective, and responsive. Preventive, before shit happens. Detective, while shit is happening, you have something in place that tells you that shit is happening. Shit is happening, or shit has just happened. How to react? Yeah, and after the shit has happened, you have damage, and you have to correct the damage. And it's all about your CIA, of your information and your IT infrastructure, and what can you put in place? You always have to think about the tripod. You have to put into place some parts of that belong to technology. You have to do something about your processes, and you have to do something about your people. So people, process, and technologies, those are the three possibilities you can use to guarantee the right level of CIA on four moments in time, before shit happens, while shit is happening, just after the shit happened, and some time after the shit has made a lot of trouble. Yep. Just take a simple glance at this picture. It will only illustrate that complexity is the enemy of security. In the early days, it was quite simple. You had one standalone computer, personal computer. That is maybe where you started. Way, way, way back in time, in the 60s, the 20th century, we had a mainframe, a big machine that was the server, and we had thumb clients. Very dumb. Terminals. And everything was under control because everything was centralized. Then we started to put next to the centralized mainframe modern type of automation mid-systems. They were called mini-systems or mid-systems. The first step into client-server for small organizations. You had a small server in an office, maybe under the desk of the financial man, and all the terminals were connected to this system. It was central, but it was small, and it was not locked and safeguarded like a mainframe. Then came the standalone computer. It was quite easy. You had it on your desk and you could do everything you wanted to do in a simple way. And then the industry started to connect everything. Mainframe was connected to mini or mid systems and connected PCs into bigger networks, first locally, then wide area, then came the internet, and everything was connected with everything, and everyone was connected with everyone. And the whole situation became complex. And now, with the coming of tablets, PDAs, smartphones, whatever, it's complexer, and even complexer, and it won't stop there. We don't know what will be the next thing. The Internet of Things, machines communicating with machines with no human involved. The more complex your IT infrastructure is, the more difficult it is to make it secure. But you can't stop technology. It goes on. And if consumers find out that it's very handy and convenient to use something, they want to bring their own devices into the office. And you have to enable them to use their own devices to communicate with the company's network. And we are, you are, always on. Your smartphone is maybe put on silence, but it's not put out. So you, all the time you are transmitting signals. Those signals are received. How? Well, that's quite complex. Secure? You can't know who's listening in. So the more complex the situation has become or is becoming, the harder it is to secure the information in your IT infrastructure. But it doesn't work if you use FUD. Scare people, oh, the NSA or the MIVD or the AIVD is listening. The Chinese are spying on us. The Russians are spying on us. Everybody is spying on everybody. Yes, we know. Since WikiLeaks, we know. Be open about it. Be clear about it. And say, yes, it happens. And if you are afraid, you can do this or that or something else. It doesn't help selling security if you are fudding. So that our minister Plasterk survived is nice for him, but the parliament was not informed right, not well, not in time, got wrong information about the 8.8 million records. So don't scare people. Ah, information. Oh, IT infrastructure. Oh, information security. It's scary. Don't try to secret. Don't tell anything about information security or your IT infrastructure. You don't have to tell everything. But you have to tell something. And don't say it doesn't happen at us or with us if the people think it's happening in the Netherlands too. Biggest mistake in an organization when regarding information security is make the decision to put in a lot of technology. You have to consider it like a tripod. If you use one of the three legs of this chair and you put it out, you make it longer, put a lot of technology in, then this tripod is hanging over. So you have to find a way to arrange all the three legs of this stool to sit properly. And most organizations think, oh, security problem, IT infrastructure, put in another application, do something about antivirus. Okay, then we buy a security incident and event monitoring program. We are going to put in locks on the door with biometrics. We ask everybody to, if they want to enter our office building, to look into the iris scanner because that's safe and secure. Bullshit. That's only one leg. If you want to put technology into the organization, you have to be clear about where, in which process, do you want to put the technology in and what are the consequences for the people who work in these processes using technology. And that is not an easy thing to do. The final stepping stone, open disclosure of vulnerabilities, is good for security. We had a great organization called GovCert. It doesn't exist any longer because it became a part of the National Cybercrime Security Center, and they, when they were a kind of own organization, they always had a kind of how they did a waarschuwingsdienst, a warning service. When there was a new vulnerability found, they published about it, and when they knew how to close this vulnerability, they wrote a small letter how to deal with this vulnerability. Therefore, open disclosure is very good. If you are a person who likes to, well, how do I say it nicely, tests security, and you want to test in a way that we call penetration testing, and you put on a certain kind of hat with a certain kind of color, and you call yourself a white hat hacker, then you are trying to look for vulnerabilities and bring those vulnerabilities you found into the open, so that you make other people or organizations aware of a vulnerability that was not known. You put it into the open after you inform the organization who has this vulnerability. And after informing this organization, this company is able to close the vulnerability. A real criminal hacker is looking for the same vulnerabilities, not to bring it into the open, but to use it to make an entrance into the IT infrastructure of the company he was trying to intrude on. If you don't know that there are vulnerabilities, you can't do something against it. So it's good to disclose. And it's legal and ethical to do so. It would be unethical if you found something and you don't give a warning to an organization where you found a weakness in the system. I'll put a break here. 12 stepping stones. You need to be aware of all these 12 steps, and if you step them 1 through 12 or 12 to 1 or whatever range you would like, then you are able to achieve information security. And I will also tell you how not to achieve information security. But before we go into this, we have a break. My watch says, how about 50 minutes break? Is that enough for you?
Yes.
Five over half five verder? Yes?
Yes. One more.
So we had a break. We know all about the W's according information security. We know which 12 stepping stones you have to touch if you want to achieve success on the front of information security. How can you make it possible to achieve the right amount of information security? You see on this slide three circles. The normal way an organization is trying to achieve information security is starting at one, to establish something, to develop a policy, to write procedures, to put it into the organization, into the processes, and then hoping that every person in the organization is performing conform the policies. After a while, the organization discovers that not everybody is acting conform the policies and the procedures. They discover this mainly when an audit is performed. How well are we doing? That can be an internal audit, but even worse, if you have an external audit, some outsiders come into your organization and are looking into how compliant are you in regard to the policies, and mainly how compliant are you to the laws and the regulations. The results of an internal or an external audit are used by the management or the board of directors to enforce the people in the organization. You have to comply to the policies and the procedures we wrote down. Sometime later, the organization will discover that not all the employees are complying with all the policies and all the procedures, because they forgot that they had to educate the employees. Why do you need this policy? Why do you have to follow this procedure? Why is it necessary to maintain a high level of information security? So, at a point that it's nearly too late, they start raising awareness about information security. So starting at one, establishing by policy making, followed by enforcing, number two, after an audit, and then number three, raising finally awareness in the organization, is the wrong way to achieve information security. The best way is to start with number three, education. To raise the awareness, what is information security and how can everybody in the organization make the best contribution to have the right level of CIA regarding to information and IT infrastructure. I'll end with awareness raising, and I'll talk you through establishing and enforcing. Establishing is boring. Remember the slide where I talk you through an organization has defined some targets, they have to perform certain activities, and therefore they have to do some sacrifices. And by doing that, they can see how efficient and how effective the organization is. That's called the area of planning and control. You can only know efficient and how effective you are if you have information about how are we doing, how are we performing. And this information can be analog on paper and digital, electronically stored, and then you have to need your IT in the form of information technology infrastructure. The board of directors or the management has two demands. They want to have insight in the real-time status of the organization, the business, the effectiveness and the efficiency of the business, and therefore they need information, and this information has to be reliable, trustworthy. And you can assure this trustworthiness or reliance by CIA. If that is what the management or the board of directors demands, they have a couple of needs. They want policies and control measures in place. Here they are starting to write the information security policy, the information security procedures. They talk about the user department, the IT department, the development department, and they have a person assigned with all the information systems and a person assigned with the IT infrastructure. This is the C business. The CFO, the Central Financial Officer, the CIO, Central Information Officer, maybe you have a CTO, the Central Technology Officer. It's all on C level, on management level, on board level. It's boring. Everything that comes top down, only from top and down to the user at the desk trying to work with information, doesn't work if it hasn't been asked for from the bottom and went up. So establishing is one way, only one way. And if you follow as an organization only this way, it's a dead end. It won't work. It works a bit better if you try to achieve information security by enforcing. We have to do it because the tax service says, or the government says, or the law says. You can invent a complete house of measures to control and achieve your information security, but you can also make use of what is available in the outside world. And then you come across something that is called a standard, the information security standard. Based on the best practices according to information security in the Western world, there are two layers consisting together out of 10 countermeasures, safety controls, or how you want to call them, to enforce information security. 3 out of 10 are essential legal obligations. If you don't put them into place, you have a legal problem. You can be sued, or you can get a fine. And 7 out of 10 are best practices. And if you are able as an organization to put all these 10 measures into your organization, you have a basic level. It's your baseline for information security. What you absolutely must do, you're obliged to protect your personal information in your organization, it is in relation with privacy. If you are not caretaking well enough about the personal information of your employees, of your customers, of whoever you are dealing with as an organization, you are being illegal and you can get fined because you are trespassing the law about privacy and personal information. The second rule is protection of specific business documents. If you are in business, you are making arrangements with your customers, you are making arrangements with partners who deliver, for example, materials you need to produce your products. And every contact you have with a customer or with a supplier comes in the form of a contract, an arrangement. And you have to keep these contracts for a certain amount of time within your organization. For example, you have to be able as an organization to deliver all your financial statements to the tax office during at least 7 years after closing a booking year. So you have a lot of administrations in your business that you have to be forced to keep for. And if you can't prove that something was agreed upon the way you think it was, and you can't produce evidence in the form of a contract or a letter or whatever, you have a problem. You can get a lawsuit or a fine. So you have the need of specific rules and procedures to retain your business documents for a serious amount of time. And if you fail to do that, you are in legal trouble. And the third rule is about intellectual property. If you make a new invention or produce a new service and it's unique, you want to safeguard it so that another company can't use your invention. That's called intellectual property. If you write a document or a paper or a book, you're the author. And then you have legal protection that's on the work you wrote. If you use a specific name for your company or for the products that you make and deliver, you can safeguard this logo as intellectual property. And anybody or any company that wants to misuse or use the same logo can be sued. So you have to realize that legally every organization is forced to protect personal information, specific business documents, and everything about intellectual property. If you fail to do one of these three things, or two of the three, or none of the three, you have a legal problem. Then there are seven measures that you have to put in place for a minimum information security level. You need a policy for information security. What do we as an organization think is information security for us? And what level do we want to achieve? Who is responsible in our organization for information security? And those people have to be appointed as responsible for information security. You have to be sure to raise awareness and train and educate your employees throughout the whole organization about information security. Then, you have to make sure that all the applications you have in use are correctly processing the information. Garbage in is garbage out. So if the information that goes into an application to be worked upon is bad, then there comes bad information out of it. But if the information that goes into an application is correct, but the application is not well developed and does something wrong with the information, you get bad information out of the application. So the software developers have to be aware, made aware, that they should build secure applications. And that's not an easy job to do. You have to be aware that your technical vulnerabilities, so everything that can go wrong regarding to your IT infrastructure, is in control. But you know which vulnerabilities there are, and that you have countermeasures in place. And if a new technical vulnerability comes into the open, that whoop, you try to immediately, if possible, try to stop this vulnerability. And you have to be in control of your business continuity. Think about the C in CIA. Your information must have a high level of continuity, but your digital information comes out of your IT infrastructure, so that has to have a high level of continuity too. If one of or two of the components doesn't function, your business can be out tomorrow. So your business continuity is depending on the continuity of your information, that is depending on the continuity of your IT infrastructure. And if shit happens, an information security incident, you have response in place, and if a disaster happens, you have a recovery in place. And if you want to improve your level of information security, you have to do it in a controlled way. It's quite simple. You only have to be sure that you have at least these 10 measures, countermeasures, controls in place to have a baseline of information security. It sounds simple. But I'll show you in a couple of minutes why it's not so simple as it sounds. Educating. Well, that's the main part, raising awareness. The best way to start is raising awareness. So not starting with establishing or enforcing, start with educate. How to do it and what to use. Do you know AIDA? It's an opera by Verdi. AIDA comes from marketing. And they use this AIDA, A-I-D-A formula, because it says everything. AIDA means, I want to have your attention. How do I get your attention? To show you something of interest. And if I show you something of interest for you, you can feel a desire, you want to know more. And if the desire is strong enough, you want to take action. So this is how marketing works. If you want to sell a product, all the marketeers use the AIDA formula. I'm trying to help you with the AIDA formula. You put AIDA to the people in your organization, but use something extra. Confrontation, storytelling, and investigating. Okay. It doesn't help if you develop policies, procedures, a lot of paper, a lot of rules, whatever. It doesn't help if you simply try to establish those 10 minimum measures. It helps if you have an organization who thinks, oh, we are doing right, to show this organization that it's not good enough. How? By confronting the organization with the results. You put a thermometer in the body of the organization and you look at the thermometer. How high is the temperature or how low is the temperature? And you want to give them a feeling of shock. Okay. What I often did with my students in the part-time program is investigate their own organization, the company they work for, because during daytime they work at the company, and in the evening, twice a week, they come here to school to have their lectures. I had a course called about information security, and every year I asked them to audit their own organization. How did I do it? Any organization, how small or how big, is not of interest. The question to answer is, this organization, where do you stand in accordance to the security code, those 10 measures I showed you? The students go to their company and they do a quick scan in a small amount of time, a small amount of questions, and they did a quick scan, a battery of questions, and they put them to employees on three levels. The highest level of management, an operational manager, and a person on the work floor, in the daily processes. They had the same questions, and based upon the answers given to those questions, you can see how mature the organization is in comparison with the 10 measures. You can also see how conscious the organization is about information security. And you can also see if at least the 10 measures that you used to have are in place. And based on the results, the student can give some suggestions for improvement of the level of information security. They used an automated quick scan tool, and this tool was based on the international ISO information security code 27002. So the question is, where do you stand? And the answer is, here do you stand in accordance to. Look and see. This is the complete code. I don't want to talk you through it. It starts here with policy, and it ends here with compliance. This is the tool, the automated tool. It's in Dutch. The same categories out, and you can give answers per item. There are several questions, and if you answer a question yes, then it's green. If you answer all the questions, no, it's red. And if you have several yes and several no's, then it's yellow. If you have three employees answering all the questions, you can compare. This is an example from a company where the information security manager, the system administrator, and a corporate secretary who was involved with information security policies and procedures. Those three people answered, and you can see per category their answers. You see a lot of differences. If you simply visualize the answers on the three legal obligations, you see quite a lot of differences. Based on the answers, the maturity level is calculated. You can have level 0, then you are completely unconscious about information security and you have no measures in place. If you are level 1, maturity level 1, you have some ad hoc measures or controls. Level 2, repeated. Level 3, defined. Level 4, controlled. And level 5, optimized. Maybe you know the CMMI, Capability Maturity Model. Not been talked about during your education until now? Okay. If you have all the 10 measures in place, you should be at least at level 3. Defined, the baseline is in place. Before I send my students on this assignment, I ask the students, what do you think after doing this assignment, what will be the maturity level of your organization regarding to information security? What do you think? Which level they answered? If you could make a guess, a common organization would be mainly on level, maturity level?
Zero.
Zero? Why zero?
Well, if you see how many companies are getting crushed by security related incidents, I think a lot of companies are a little bit aware.
You're a pessimist.
Maybe.
Anybody thinks a common organization would be at what level?
Probably 4 or 5.
4 or 5. The optimist. Okay, yep. We have both ends of the scale. The students, part-time students, working as an IT person in a daily job, answered nearly all of them at least level 3. And some of them even said, they worked with well-known companies, I can't mention names, we are at level 4, and there even were two who said, our company is at level 5. After doing the quick scan, the calculation of the maturity level was done. And all of the organizations, of all of the students, during three years in a row, had maturity level 0. Why? Because they all went down on the three legal obligations. One or more. Intellectual property, business documents, and personal information. So all the organizations then there were between 20 or 30 students per year during the course were doing illegal business, could have the risk of being fined or being sued. So if you use confrontation as a means to raise awareness, if you put this in front of the board of directors or the management, they will have something, wow, that's bad. Yes, that's bad. Who are we going to look for to blame? Ho, 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 that's not, we are not going to blame anyone. Nobody is guilty. The whole organization is guilty. And the board of directors or the management is the most guiltiest party. Because they are the owners of the information and the owners of the information technology infrastructure. So they are to blame, not all the employees of the organization. So this is a good way to raise awareness. You have their interest and you have their desire to do something. They don't know how to act, but you can give them advice. Another way to raise awareness is by storytelling. Storytelling is about narrative. You all know a fairy tale from your childhood. Once upon a time, there were a boy and a girl called Hans and Grietje. And then this happened, and that happened, and that happened. But at the end, they live happily ever after. If you want to use storytelling, that is what I'm going to teach you in the course of electronic discovery, how to tell a story, you use the question, what happened? And based on your discovery of what happened, you are going to build a story with a clear beginning, main body where a lot of things go wrong, and a happy as possible ending. And you use the 5 until 7 W questions. What you use by storytelling to raise awareness about information security is taking one information security incident that just happened and investigate that incident to be able to answer the question what happened and how did it happen, and then put it all in a story. The problem is, if you do want to do an investigation like a digital forensic investigation, you've been asked to answer a couple of questions. Did this person do that? Was this person involved in this action? Was this computer used to do something? You have to dig for information to be able to answer these questions. So you are in demand of reliable and correct data, pieces of information. And because the information is mainly electronically stored, you have to dig into the computer system and look in all the areas of a computer system to find digital traces of an activity that has been done. And to put all these digital traces in the right order to be able to tell the story this has happened, and this is the way it happened. How you do such an investigation is something we do in a masterclass. Arnhem and I did it in France. And this is what I'm doing in my part-time minor e-discovery. You learn how to investigate incidents. In a forensically, scientifically, and legally sound way. What you learn in this minor is doing it at least in a forensically sound way. Okay. If shit happens and you found out what exactly happened and how it happened, then after you finished digging and investigating, you can build a story. For example, I told you about the money in the bank. You can tell a story about real money in the real world. It starts here and it goes this way. And then it goes into the bank. And here the money is in the vault after being counted, after being delivered to the bank from the cash tray out of the shop. At the counter you have this machine where you can put in all the bills of money. After you have checked the money if it's real money and not false money. And because of privacy, you want the next customer to wait behind the yellow line. So this could be a story, the normal way, the normal process. You can play with this story if you want to tell something about where it went wrong. The car who delivered the cash money from the shop to the bank was stopped for, and the money was robbed out of the car. The money that was put into the vault of the bank, there was a gang that drilled a hole in the wall and came into the back of the bank and the vault, and they took all the money out of the vault. You can think of everything. Some examples. So you can illustrate the real world, this time real money, and face it with real threats. You can also tell a story about the virtual world. We have virtual money in the real world. Well, several ways. At this time, we can pay with cards. In what form? The credit cards. We all know this one. Your virtual money, digitally, electronically stored information, can also be threatened. Maybe you know the Barings Bank, Nick Leeson, a trader in Singapore, who was trading on his own for his bank and took millions of dollars from his bank. We had the French guy, Jérôme Kerville, the bank Société Générale, who frauded and took from his bank quite a lot of money. The Iceland affair, he stored a lot of money in a bank in Iceland and it was vanished. The DSB, small private bank in the Netherlands that suddenly went broke. from the inside, but you can also have an outside threat. Threat don't have to come only from your own employees, but it can also come from the outside world, the bad, bad world. Because in a virtual world, it's possible to perform a crime from a distance. The only thing you need is a computer, an internet connection, and a smart idea. And this is the way, for example, how money laundering takes place. You put it on a banking account in the Netherlands, then transfer it through different banks to the Cayman Islands, and then from the Cayman Islands to Aruba or whatever. Nobody knows. Or you are performing a lot of phishing. Yesterday I saw in my mailbox two mails from the Rabobank that they announced that they had a lot of troubles during the last weeks, and that now everything was in order, and I simply had to click on a link and then everything would be okay and I could reassure my account and my information with the Rabobank. I'm not a customer at the Rabobank, so it went into the bin. So even out of jail or in jail, from jail, you can perform virtual theft of virtual money. And you can't read what's standing here. Nobody knows who's at the end of the computer. And nobody knows I'm a dog. I'm not a human. So, besides confronting, you can tell a story. And there is a third possibility to raise awareness about information security, and that's doing an investigation. An investigation about a really happened information security incident. It's like being a detective, looking into clues and being able to decide if a crime has happened, and if yes, what crime it was and how it was performed. And then you need, like in real forensics, traces. Normally in real forensics you have fingerprints, you have all kinds of material, but in digital forensic investigations you only have digital traces, and they are not so easy to find, and they are very, very vulnerable. Before you know it, it could be disappearing, because digital traces can be very volatile. It depends on where the traces are. If it's in a part of your IT infrastructure that needs power to maintain the data, then you can get hold of those data. If you put the power off, a lot of that data is missing, is gone. And the data that remains for the longest time is on your hard drive, when it's part of your IT infrastructure. It can even last longer if you have burned it on a CD, or it's on a DVD or a thumb drive. Okay, shit happens. So do incidents. During the investigation, you choose an incident. That an incident is an unpleasant and or unexpected event. An incident has always effects. It affects your liability. Did you legally did something wrong? You have a big problem. You need a lawyer. Is there a contractual liability? that you have to do something in according to a contract and you failed, then you need a lawyer too. An incident can also have effects because it causes damage. That can be direct, immediate during and after the incident, but it can also be indirect damage later in time. The damage can be for your business. No money comes in and no money can go out. It can damage your property, your IT infrastructure, for example, can be caught in a fire. And it can also be personal damage. The result of this damage can be that you receive complaints, that you have to recall your products. Another Toyota that has been called in because there was a problem discovered again. There can come claims from other organizations or private people who lost something, and you can get lawsuits, litigations. And then, if there is damage, you have first the duty to prove that you did everything according to the law. And if you can't prove it because you have lack of information, you have another problem. Your sentence will be higher. And it can be that you have the burden of proof. You are forced to prove to the government. So, shit happens. It's not always possible to prevent an incident, although you have preventive measures in place. But what you can do is at least try to minimize the damage by preventive, detective, and reactive measures. Okay, you take a simple incident and you do a correct investigation. And the results of this investigation you can show to the management or to the board of directors. And that's another way of confronting the organization with the things that went well and the things that went wrong. And you now can raise the awareness again, and you've shaken them up and they want to do something. And then there's you. You can give them advice how to do better information security. Every incident you can answer by the 8W questions. I won't go into detail. I'll come back on this model in the course Electronic Discovery. Summing up, before I give you an assignment, a little assignment. No organization, no person is free from security incidents. Murphy is always on. Incidents can be controlled because you have a risk to face an incident. Every risk can be mitigated by measures. Then it's controlled. There is one risk you can't controlled by a measure, and that's the human. We will be, until the end of the days, the weakest link. So the best thing to do is raise awareness among the humans. It's bad now. It could be worse, but suppose it's bad. You want it to become better. Then you have the urgency that it's essential to reduce the risks according to information security and the effects those risks can have on your information. CIA. How to get there? Raising conscious and then not only enforcing or only establishing, or only educating? Better not first enforcing, then establishing, and then educating. Start with educating by raising consciousness through awareness. Use confronting, storytelling, and investigating as means, and then keep the level up. We tend to forget what we learn. We can tell you many, many times, be aware, make backups, close your internet connection. And then something goes wrong. And then, ah, shit. Yes, yes, yes. Of course, she said, he said, I know, I knew, I should have done that, but I... So every time you make a mistake, you have to think about, was it new for me or was it a slip of mind? You will be continuing making mistakes. But learn from your mistakes. If you want to know more about information security, there's a free copy available with the ground knowledge on information security in Dutch. I've got an assignment for you. Sigh. I hear a sigh. Okay. Picture this. We have a goose, and a goose is a special goose because it lays golden eggs. The golden eggs is your information. The goose is your IT infrastructure. They belong together. The story about the goose that laid the golden eggs is a famous old story. It comes from a Roman writer, the times of the old Romans. The guy is called Aesop, in Dutch Aesopus, and he wrote a fable about the goose and the golden eggs. Why about the goose? Because in Dutch it's the kip and the gouden eieren. Because it's a Roman story, and in ancient Italy they had quite a lot of geese. They used geese to eat them, to produce eggs, but they also used geese to protect the property. Geese will always gag if somebody who is a stranger to a property enters a property. And in the Netherlands we don't have geese so much, but we have a lot of chicken. That's why this phrase, the goose that laid the golden eggs, was translated into the kip met de gouden eieren into Dutch. So we use the chicken, the rest of the world uses the goose. The story about the fable is quite simple. There was a couple, a man and a woman who had possession of a goose, and it was a special goose because every day it laid a golden egg. And every day they collected the golden egg and they could make a perfect living because they could sell the golden egg, earn some money, and buy the stuff they needed for their daily life. But one day, this couple had an idea. Why should we wait every day for the next golden egg to come? Why not collect all the golden eggs at once? And there was only one way, they thought, to achieve that. Cut open the goose and get all the golden eggs out. That's what they did. Surprise, surprise. When they cut the goose open, they found nothing. The goose was a normal goose, and only in the process of producing an egg, the goose was able to make it a golden egg. So that's why we use now the phrase, don't slaughter the chicken with the golden eggs. Because at the end you have nothing. No more eggs, no more chicken, no more goose, no more golden eggs. So this is the story. The goose is your IT infrastructure and the golden eggs is the information that comes from the IT infrastructure and goes into the organization. You have the goose and the golden eggs, your IT infrastructure and your information. I want you to visualize what shit could happen to the eggs. Not to the goose, not to the eggs, because the eggs is the information. It's about information security. What shit could happen to the eggs? And if you have an idea about what shit could happen, how could this shit happen to the eggs? And it's your task. You can do it together if you sit next to each other. Try to visualize it. Go into internet if you want to. Google afbeeldingen or whatever pictures. Try to think about. And if you're not able to visualize, try to talk with each other. What could happen to the eggs? What negative? What shit? And concentrate on the eggs, on the information, not on the goose. Is the question clear? The answer is visualization. So use pictures you find on the internet. And if your visualization is a combination of a simple piece of text with a drawing, it's okay. Be creative and try to think, we call it, out of the box. I could use your time until 6 o'clock. I won't ask too much from you. So I want you to mail me your PowerPoint. One slide, within 10 minutes, and I have a writer. I'll tell you my...
Your assistant.
Thank you. c.a.bombelt@hva.nl. That's my email address. Mail your slide at 5:45. Start now.
Okay.
De eerste is binnen. Al de markt, de gans, de eieren, nog zo goed. Het ligt uiteindelijk in de handen van de boer. Hoezo?
Nou, dit gaat terug op dat de mens de zwakste schakel is van de leven. Je kan de informatie nog zo goed beveiligen als je wilt. Het zal uiteindelijk aan de kennis van de persoon liggen die het krijgt. Hoe die het zal bewaken, hoe die het zal verspreiden.
Prachtig! Hoe geslingerd was dit? Kwetsbaar is, want het is een ei.
Dan gebeurt misschien niks aan het.
Of dat ik weet.
Ja.
Leuk gevonden. Ja, daar komen de shit eieren.
Wat? Die dubbelbouwer is dan.
Jack shit.
Hey, dat zijn.
Van wie is deze? Daar. Oké. Okay. Die hij kan vallen, die hij kan die stone. Die hij kan hack, can be stepped on, can crack, could roll away. The golden paint could wash off. Die is de bunny hier.
Je weet het niet.
Acht verschillende vormen van shit.
Ja.
Ja. Ik heb je niet gevraagd om te bedenken hoe je dit zou kunnen voorkomen, maar je hebt in ieder geval hier al 8 categorieën waar je leuk gevonden. Nick, waar komt hij vandaan?
Mother.
Achterin, oké. What could happen to the eggs? An egg could be stolen from the goose. If there are a lot of eggs, the goose might not notice that one of her eggs has been stolen. But if someone shows the goose the egg in his hands, the goose will probably react to it. This is a metaphor for what happens with Edward Snowden and the NSA. Okay. Again, the weakest link. Met andere woorden, de NSA is voor jullie de goose en Snowden is degene die het eitje ontvreemd van de gans.
Nou, dat is wel een cruciaal verschil.
Leuk gevonden. Valerie? Ja? Oké. Hij kan rotten, gestolen worden, kwijtraken, opgegeven worden, stuk gaan. Well, it was gold, and shell was a little bigger on one hand. Dit plaatje is fantastisch. Hier hebben we een plaatje van een incident dat heeft plaatsgevonden en hier zou je dus een fantastische investigation op los kunnen laten. En op wie komen we dan? Nou, in ieder geval zit het ergens in deze categorie. Het is kwijtgeraakt of het is gestolen. En dan is de handvraag wie heeft het gedaan. Dat zou de paashaas kunnen zijn. De Easter Bunny uit een van de andere slides. Misschien heeft Snowden het gedaan. Leuk gevonden. Nog iemand een plaatje in de aanbieding, want er komt geen mail meer binnen. Mocht het nog nagekomen plaatjes zijn, ik hou me van harte aanbevolen. Zoals je merkt, jullie zijn in het Nederlands overgegaan op sommige plaatjes, dus ik mag lekker ook in het Nederlands overgaan.
Dit kunnen we toch nog publiceren hoor, al die termen in het Engels die er net...
Ja.
Die egg beep, 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 beep.
The beep that happens.
Ja, yeah, the beep that happens to the egg.
Doe de dieping egg.
Dames en heren, het was mij een enorm genoegen om jullie iets te mogen vertellen over informatiebeveiliging. Zoals je gemerkt hebt is het een heel ruim begrip waar heel veel onder valt. Maar het is wel de basis van wat jullie verder gaan doen in het kader van security. Houd dus steeds in je achterhoofd dat het uiteindelijk draait om de informatie, de data. En dat je IT-infrastructuur, computers en alles wat ermee samenhangt, dat alleen maar een hulpmiddel is om die informatie goed voor het voetlicht te brengen. Dus wat dat betreft ben ik blij dat in het kader van je vak security, information security, lekker aan het begin zit.